Hello and welcome to day 12 of the 12 Days of Winter with me, Sage Lee. I am broadcasting from the throne of the third heaven of the nation's Millennium General Assembly by sculptor James Hampton. Now, this amazing work of art behind me is the work of James Hampton, who was an untrained artist and who created this work over the span of 14 years in a rented garage. Now, he was a night janitor for the General Services Administration in Washington, D.C., and it is not clear whether he ever intended to display this work to anyone or even whether he considered it to be a work of art or not. Now, it is generally supposed that James Hampton created this work after a series of revelations that he had. And since he worked at night, by day he would wander around the streets of Washington, D.C. and find materials for the throne, like gum wrappers and candy wrappers and tinfoil and cardboard and pickle jars and blotters and all sorts of things that he would just assemble for the throne. Now, art critics call this kind of work art naif or naive art, but I call this the work of a person who is responding to his own inner guidance. Fear not is the sign that appears over this entire work, and it exemplifies James Hampton's life. He was receiving regular downloads from the divine, which were he wrote out in a loose leaf notebook that to this day has not yet been deciphered. But he didn't fear all of this. Instead, he just set about to do the work that was given to him by the divine without regard to how crazy it might seem to others. In fact, the work was only discovered in 1964 after his landlord arrived at the rented garage a month after James's death when the rent hadn't been paid. Now, wisely, the landlord understood what he was looking at and called the Smithsonian, and it was then very shortly after moved to the Smithsonian Institute, where it now lives. So today's topic is the divine masculine, understanding the divine masculine and stepping into it. And James Hampton was a total example of the divine masculine. The work he did was not ego-based. He didn't do it for his own fame and fortune. Instead, he followed divine guidance and did what the divine asked him to do. Now, there are many examples of the masculine in our culture, but not many examples of the divine masculine. To my knowledge, none of our past presidents, our president-elect, or even our current president are examples of the divine masculine. But here are some of the traits so that you can look out for the divine masculine in your life and understand when you're stepping into it. So the divine masculine, number one, responds to intuition or the call of the divine. James Hampton did this. I did this when I decided to start the School for Wizards. Krishnamurti did this in 1929 when he called all of his disciples together and he said, go home. The path is pathless. I'm not your teacher. You've got to find your path on your own. Goodbye. So number two, the divine masculine makes sure its feet are in the right place and stands firm, right? Make sure your feet are in the right place and stand firm is something that Abraham Lincoln said. And it really is a principle not only for standing up for what you believe in, but doing the extra work that's necessary to figure out whether that is really the right thing to do or not. So the third aspect of the divine masculine is making clear decisions, right? Clear decision making was exemplified by King Solomon in the Judgment of Solomon. In order to get the two women to commit to what they really truly wanted, he had to actually commit to chopping that baby in half. He had to make his decision clear in order for the truth to come out. So making clear decisions is an example of the divine masculine. The fourth aspect of the divine masculine is when making decisions, make a decision that is for the greatest good of all, right? In order for the divine masculine to be active on the earth plane, the nafs must be controlled. And the Sufis call our urges to sex, to drinking, to food, to drugs, they call them the nafs. And we must not be skewed in our decision making by these base urges. Now, it doesn't mean that we can't have sex or food or an occasional glass of wine, but it does mean that we must go through whatever period of probation and spiritual discipleship that's necessary in order for us to be able to even ask the question, what is the greatest good for all? And we have to be willing to include everyone in that decision, including ourselves. You know, when we are making or taking a big step toward expressing the divine masculine, then it's really important to do this. And you can see the divine masculine in some of the archetypes of the tarot, the Emperor card and the Hierophant card, the card of spiritual leadership, are two of the ones that exemplify some aspect of the divine masculine. So the fifth aspect of the divine masculine is stay focused. The divine feminine in the form of the Empress in the tarot deck is constantly creating, constantly moving, constantly cycling. The job of the divine masculine in the face of all this creation and movement is the editing and organizing principle of focus. The divine masculine knows what to leave out and what to leave in, what therefore to pay attention to. And for those of you in the San Francisco Bay Area, I'm actually doing a workshop starting at 1 p.m. on January 28th, 1 week after the inauguration. And no matter what you think of our new president, I think we can all agree that he does not exemplify these traits of the divine masculine that we've just gone over. He embodies another form of the masculine altogether. Now, I'm not saying that one is right or one is wrong. I'm saying that we need a balance and that we need to actually understand and know how to step into the divine masculine at this time as a counterpoint to the ego-based masculine. So we have to have this balance, and what we're doing on the 28th is actually stepping into that balance. You know, when I say stepping into the divine masculine, it doesn't mean that you have to be a male or female to do it, but it's a real special opportunity for men to understand how to do that. So go to the link in the description below. If that doesn't work, then email me, and I will personally save you a space at this. Email me at sage@theschoolforwizards.com. Until next time, thank you so much. Bye for now.